it's every town's worst nightmare to find their church on fire.
It's just horrifying. It just, so much history can go down and just flames, no time.
465 on scene, 2350.
We've been part of the Martinsdale community for over 100 years. It's just a very painful experience for many people.
We just started stringing out lines, trying to figure out which doors we could get in. We weren't really able to get in at all.
Rapidly took over the building, and there was just no working it, no cutting it down. It just, it was too far gone before we were able to do anything.
And at that point, we knew we had to let the building go.
This church had been here a long time, so it's sad to see it go.
My dad went to this church. I mean, my grandma went to this church. I was baptized here. My first communion was here. I met a lot of my friends here. This was my place to go when I was a kid, my safe house.
Here goes.
So many memories of baptisms and weddings and funerals.
Everybody can relate that lives in a small community. And it just, it hurts. I don't care who you are, it hurts.
At a high school swim meet,
go, go, go!
You expect to see arms pumping, legs kicking,
go, KZ!
Serious competitors,
go!
Who are like fish in the water. But ducks?
Water, swimming, duck, because they go in water.
Rubber ducks.
I don't know why you would chuck a duck or why you would even think about chucking a duck.
Oh!
So we're chucking ducks to raise money.
You don't get to move it.
You're supposed to feel like you're on top of the world when you're a senior, and then you just get hit by this news, and it kind of just stops you in your tracks.
Megan Martin stopped swimming last May. She thought she had tendonitis and planned to power through it.
And I never thought in a million years it would be cancer.
Osteosarcoma. Because of it, Megan's been through chemo and knee replacement surgery.
Even though she can't, like, physically be in the water, she's still part of the team.
She has 6 more months of chemo to go.
We're family. We're the swim team is a family. So we are. I used to be on the swim team, and, like, it was just like, you're always there for each other. You love each other. You support each other.
Good thing you came, because it's a pretty big event.
And that's why people are paying to chuck a duck.
It's an awesome event. It has totally taken my husband and I and our daughter by surprise.
The money is going to the American Cancer Society in Megan's name.
The community support has been overwhelming.
Yeah, I know. It's pretty crazy.
She may feel a bit like a fish out of water now.
She's got a great spirit. She's always like smiling and happy.
But this competitor is powering through with the help of family and friends, and yes, those silly rubber ducks.
This gasoline-powered buzz was preceded by another sound. One that jolted Kathy Crittenbrink awake at 3 a.m.
And we heard a loud crack, and we woke up and it sounded like a gunshot, and my husband goes, "What is that?" And we came running downstairs and woke our son up, and we realized half the tree had fallen down.
15 minutes later, the other half of the pear came down. That's where Don Haig comes in.
A storm just makes it complicated.
Haig Tree Service.
My wife, Adele, she's my helper.
Hold on for just a second, and I'll ask Don when he can get over there.
Adele rides shotgun, plotting out where Don's crew of 6 men will spend the next week cutting large limbs into small, while across town,
Jared McNeil's approach is just to take it all in one big piece.
Trying to help out neighbors, get it all taken care of, so we can get back to our original lives.
There's nothing unusual about snow in November, but when it's this heavy and it collects on leaves that are still attached, Don explains,
if you took a 5-pound sack of sugar and held your arm straight out,
sure, you could hold it for a while.
But after a while, your arm just won't take anymore. That's what these trees do.
We had to have a tree removed, and it was like $800 this past summer, so this has to be double that.
But Kathy can take some comfort in knowing she's not alone.
Yeah, I've got a list of, we just took some sticky notes, probably 10 or 15 sticky notes in here that we'll organize and go to later this afternoon and try to do them in order of emergencies. And my phone's ringing again.
came up to pay my respects. The gentleman was in the same branch, the same rank, the same base that I was stationed at. I was there from 66 to 68.
Patriot Yard, in put.
He was from here in Ottumwa and a great guy. And so people just wanted to come out here regardless if you knew him or you didn't know him.
And it's sad that we have to go through it, but it's great that the people are here to back this guy. I mean, it's just, the sergeant was a great man.
Well, there was a gentleman that was just walking up the hill and somebody said something about him sweating, and he said, I can sweat when someone else gives their life for me.
You got the Boy Scouts holding flags. You've got people that are just, have probably never met this guy before, you know, that are holding flags. And the people, it's, I haven't seen this many flags for years. There was a dull roar that I didn't, at first couldn't figure out what it was. And then I started listening, then I heard the bikes rolling in.
We even counted down and we got to like roughly 100, and there's over 100, and my son was counting with us, and he said, look at all these motorcycles, look at all these people. So it was just kind of take your breath away kind of thing.
He's a hero, and Wapello County will always remember him.
I don't even know him, but I wanted to come out here and show that we care. And we are behind our troops 100%. We wouldn't have our freedom today if they weren't out here fighting for our country.
How are you this morning? Oh.
The saying goes, there are no menial jobs, only menial attitudes.
$7.07, please.
In lane 7, mixed amongst the chewing gum and the impulse buys,
where there's a smile in every aisle,
that's where you'll find Bob Borg. Raised in a musical family, proficient in violin and trombone, Bob worked several other jobs throughout his life. And then, about 18 months ago, he discovered something. That grocery stores attract the grumps.
And one day, as I was counting back change, I think it musically in my head, and it came out of my mouth. It drew a big smile.
And once he started, man, it was like...
Music is just something I love to listen to.
Well, it's like he can't stop.
To speak it and have it come out, it's wonderful.
Singing Bob has become a fixture at the Johnston Hy-Vee.
And I'm incorrigible and uninhibited, so I did it some more, and the next thing I know... $30.22, please. Oh, I've got this reputation of singing.
He'll sing anywhere.
2040, thank you. Would you like that receipt?
Nah, you can pitch it.
I'll take care of that. Occasionally you get people that aren't interested, and they'll go to a different line or tease me, and I don't mind if people laugh at me or with me. Either way, laughter is a good thing.
By the way... Did you notice?
He's always happy all the time. All the time he's happy.
Oh, he sings and it's lovely.
I don't really sing. It's more of a musical font for my voice.
He really does sing.
If other people who have shopped the store will say, come on, you got to go through Bob's lane, he'll sing to you.
Three Honeycrisp.
And Bob's boss loves what it does for business. When Jim Carney arrived last year, the new store director couldn't believe his ears.
And I just thought, wow, that's interesting. And then, so you wonder if customers like it or how receptive they'll be.
Everything in the bag, all right.
But the vast majority of customers just love it. I mean, as you can see, all of the women go through Bob's lane so they can be serenaded.
Oh, here are your flowers.
Sorry, ladies.
Thank you, Sheila.
He's taken.
And by the end of the day, I go home and my wife says, calm down.
He probably sings himself to sleep every night.
$16.80, please.
But then most mornings, he's back in lane 7 because menial attitudes need not apply. Because in lane 7, there's never a mundane moment.
All the customers that want to go through Bob's lane because he brings brightness to their day.
It's circular. It's very rewarding. 25, 34. And if I can contribute just a little bit to that, then I'm doing a good thing. And I like doing good things.
In Johnston, Dan Winters, Channel 13 News.
Thank you.
The water changes everything. Foils gravity, reinvents movement, challenges breath. And for 14-year-old Caleb Utesh, it blends him back in with the crowd.
I think I just always liked swimming from the start.
44-4, that's great!
Seeing myself keeping up with other people kind of gives me the feeling that I'm doing well at it.
It's definitely made him stronger in his core section, and he,
He swims the butterfly. I mean, that's a stroke most kids won't even want to attempt.
He does more than keep up. Utesh swims varsity in the sport's two most grueling events, the 100-yard butterfly and the 500 freestyle.
He really keeps up very well, and that's his goal.
That's impressive for a freshman, but maybe not surprising given that Caleb comes from a swimming family. Older brother Ben is at Division I Oakland University and is a former state champion at Ames.
Take your marks.
There is a surprise, though. You just have to wait for it.
It all started one night. I'd kind of been having pains on my leg, like in this area.
Just noticed an odd swelling above his knee. It didn't look like a normal bruise. It was hard to, you know, even realize what it was.
It was diagnosed the next day as a malignant peripheral nerve sheath tumor in then 9-year-old Caleb's leg. An amputation was unavoidable. The news reached his club coach quickly.
The hardest thing was how fast it happened from when it was diagnosed to when the surgery took place. That's what I remember. To me, it just seems like instantaneously, this 7-year-old boy loses his leg.
Once again, the water changed everything.
My surgery was in April, and then I got back in the water late May, maybe.
Climb on up.
He was pretty thin and, you know, pretty sick-looking little boy, but he got right back in with Coach Dan's encouragement and competed right away, and I was really happy that he had encouraged that.
I feel like he was back in the water swimming before he was walking again.
Walking would come back to him, though his impressive poolside hop remains a specialty.
I think if he had to choose the prosthetic leg or no leg, he'd probably go the no leg route. But I think the physical therapist pushed him to use that leg often as much as he can.
Back in the water, Utesh's skill will very likely propel him further than the state swimming meet at Iowa. The Paralympic Games have come calling, and he's begun competing in their trial events. He could travel the world and win big.
People know who he is, you know, and they know who he is because how young he is and how well he's swimming.
They don't know him for what he doesn't have. The loss isn't lamented. In fact, it's almost forgotten. You see, the water is a different playing field, and it changes everything. In Ames, Andy Fales, Channel 13 News. Time can be an enemy, for brides in particular.
For one day, all the focus is on you.
For all that goes into planning the big day, it seems it slows to a stop once the day arrives.
I'm very excited. I'm ready for it. I've been ready for it for a while now.
The wedding was supposed to be in December, but was moved up.
I've already had my dress, thankfully, so that's the biggest part of it, but everything else was pushed into 3 days. And it's been amazing how everything has just fallen into place.
Probably over there in the corner.
The decorations are ready. Flowers just so.
There you go.
The chapel all set for guests.
I'm totally ready. I've known Andrew, oh gosh, since I was in high school, and you know, it's been perfect for us. We've had our ups and downs like every couple does, but we're ready to make that next step to be, you know, husband and wife.
Time has been working against Michael Lewis too. He's been battling cancer for nearly 4 years.
I actually don't think I've actually even gotten scared or cried until maybe about a month ago.
He recently entered hospice care and has been searching for closure.
It's something that, you know, I'm not scared. Yeah, I believe in God. And I feel like I've always been a Christian. But it's one of those things I feel worse for those I'm leaving behind.
I promise I'm trying not to stick you.
But this day, if he could just get this boutonniere pinned, this is a good day.
One, two, three.
He's here, and so is his daughter's wedding day.
When she told me that her and Andrew were engaged, I was like, I knew it would happen. They've known each other a long time, and I've always loved Andrew.
Hospice prepares families for a dark day, but on this one, the Kavanaugh house brings only light, granting bride and father a final wish.
He's like, I don't even care if I have to come down in my bed. He's like, I will be there. I I've always been a daddy's girl from day one, and that to know that my dad might not be there in December, it's like I needed that sense of peace of knowing that my dad was able to give me away at my wedding.
Looks beautiful. Just like the day she was born.
Weddings are about new beginnings, but this one offers more.
Love never fails.
Closure to a family that needs it most.
I know that innocence should be taken care of.
For the first day in a long while, time yielded to the Lewises. The big day arrived, and they were all here to see it. In Windsor Heights, Andy Fales, Channel 13 News.
I told you, I don't care if you're black or white. I don't care if you're rich or poor. I don't care where you come from, whether it's Texas, Florida, California, or right here in the state of Iowa. I don't care about any of that. But what I did care about is moving forward from that day on that we were one team.
Feel it coming in the air. Yeah. And the screams from everywhere. Yeah. I'm addicted to the thrill. It's a dangerous love affair. Can't be scared.
Barnett takes the snap and drops, throws it deep down the left side for Reynolds, caught, touchdown, Zarius Reynolds!
Whedon to throw it, firing downfield for Blackman, a leaping catch at the five, and he'll take it in for the touchdown.
If you have hopes of pulling this upset, you got to find a way to get the ball into the end zone.
And he hands it off to White on the zone read, 30, 25, White to the outside, 20, 15, 10, 5, touchdown! Here comes the blitz, and Whedon sets up and fires right. It's intercepted! It's picked off by Leonard Johnson! Barnett to throw, into the end zone, diving catch, touchdown! Albert Derry! 24 apiece, minute 21 to go. Snap is good, so is the hold, kick on the way, and it is no good! Wide right! Wide right!
That we were one team. That we were unified and we were one team, and you were bought into it, hook, line, and sinker.
Over the middle, deflected and intercepted by Karen Benton.
And for that, men, I am so proud.
Who won this town tonight?
Barnett, hands to Woody, up the middle, touchdown.
It's one of the best cities you probably could ever come to.
Really ugly backup southbound. It looks like the morning rush, it is just thick through here.
It's a great place, very friendly people. Wonderful environment.
Favorite city in the entire United States.
And what's not to love? There's something for everyone in Chicago. From the 26 miles of lakefront to the bustling downtown.
I would describe it as fast-paced, energetic, fun, exciting.
And of course, landmarks known around the world.
I have no idea why they changed the name to Willis Tower.
I still call her Sears Tower too. Willis, what's that?
You know what, I've been up there before, and yeah, it's a tall building.
Big business rules. You have to be tough to survive.
It's pretty competitive, so you know you need to be on top of your game.
We're standing 1,450 feet and 110 stories tall.
But this gives a whole new meaning to corporate climb.
This is definitely a different way to do it, so should be fun.
I think it's pretty incredible. We just started.
Woo! Nice job, keep it up.
We're almost done?
Yep.
I do about 6 or 7 races a year, stair races a year. This is by far the most energetic, the most fun.
Hi. My name's Mark.
Mark Block's here for the fun.
How are you? Good to see you.
And to see a lot of friends.
What's up, buddy?
I'm excited to see you up on the top.
We're not going for time, we're going to finish.
His team has been training for months.
There's no 103-floor building in Des Moines, so we have to take buildings in laps.
There are more than 2,000 people here from 38 states and 7 countries.
The first time is 1822.
And most everyone has a target time in mind.
We're going to be starting here in the next few seconds, all right?
Okay.
Don't go blowing out of the gate.
The elite competitors get to the top in about 13 minutes.
All right. Here we go.
Deep breaths.
For Mark,
kick the back of the stair.
It will take a bit longer.
I think the rise is a little high. Yeah.
He knows better than most what it takes to survive.
25 years ago, after a car wreck, I was paralyzed from my neck down. The doctors told my parents that I'd never move again.
When Mark came out of the coma, he refused to believe that he'd never walk again. After months of therapy and years of hard work, he was back to normal until a few years ago.
I fell and hit my head and got another spinal cord injury, which left me paralyzed on this side.
Feet way wide apart.
He returned to the same room at Yonker Rehab in Des Moines, relearning how to do the basics.
Being able to just hold a fork or hold a spoon or a knife and to dress myself, and then the ability to walk.
You got it, you're looking good, take your time.
The people at the Rehabilitation Institute of Chicago.
Nice work.
Help Mark go beyond the basics.
Courageous, inspiring, that's why we do what we do.
Looking strong.
They're in these stairwells because the climb raises money for RIC.
It's a pretty big challenge, but it's not nearly as much of a challenge as what most of our patients go through every day.
Ow.
They help people recover from traumatic illnesses and injuries.
You got this, 200 feet, you can do this.
And more importantly, reclaim their lives.
You make it look easy, it's not.
This is how Mark covered more than 100 floors last year. He set a goal to do the climb again.
Oh, this is awesome.
On his feet.
Almost there, fifth of the way done.
When your body tells you it's time to quit, it's your mind that tells you it's time to keep going.
It's a very humbling experience.
You guys are doing awesome. Keep going.
He's amazing, though.
Keep it up.
Doing great.
Thanks. Up and over.
Woo-hoo!
Up and over.
Come on, 49. You can do it.
There we go.
Yay, we're almost there.
No, halfway there.
50, nice.
This is hard.
Oh, this kicks my butt.
Welcome to the 60th floor, guys.
Good job, Team Ability.
Thanks. We're doing it, Mike.
Yes, we are.
Every step is hard work. The final floors are agony. The finish, pure elation.
Yeah! Yeah!
You have to be tough to survive this climb.
I would have crawled with my fingernails if I had to. Mike, I don't know if Mike would have let me, but I'd have gone down on my knees and climbed with my knees if I had to.
103 floors, more than 2,100 stairs. And at the top, many things that can never really be measured.
This isn't about medals. This is about ability. And, you know, what better reward is there in life than the use of a hand or the ability to, you know, take care of yourself? It's just amazing. It's a day of amazing ability.
I just knew Nick gave me this. I was like, oh, yeah.
Things are relatively controlled and slow right now. We probably have about a third of our beds filled at this point, and you know it's almost 11 o'clock in the morning, which is kind of an easy pace for Friday morning for us, I think.
Most of my trauma rooms are open right now.
It's never dull. You never know what's going to come through the front door.
Are we ready to go?
It was an Indianola ambulance called out for a seizure-like activity. And when they got to the patient, he was starting to become more arousable or more awake again, but had a very low blood pressure.
This fluid's not running open at all.
I'll give you a call when you're ready.
Here we go. I'm gonna feel him up here.
Next step is now specialty care. Surgery will come see him. We'll try and do some invasive procedures to find out where all the air in his abdomen is coming from.
We have an inbound aircraft coming from Knoxville with an unresponsive, intubated patient.
Well, we've had a little bit of influx too. We've had
Patients have post-CPR that just arrived from another facility. So that one's an intubated patient on a ventilator that just arrived. At the same time, we had a trauma alert that was transferred from another hospital.
Trauma team to emergency.
These are kind of going spurts here and there. Doesn't really happen too often, but it can happen.
We're probably at about 85% capacity. I have a few open rooms.
And we have a pressure now, 158 over 58.
I mean, it certainly can be stressful with trying to juggle the number of patients that you're seeing at any one time. And there's no set pattern. It's where best resources are able to get to the patient as quickly as possible.
An ICU looks like they might have one opening up, but they have been tight all throughout the day.
We just got a trauma alert on about five trauma patients coming in.
Last blood pressure 150 systolic, heart rate running in the 80s and 90s.
We're gonna start out on bed one here, and the second one's gonna go over here to team two.
A lot of facial fractures. Vitals are stable. This is Linda.
Therese is a 27-year-old female patient that was a backseat passenger in a vehicle going highway speed, fully restrained. On collision, she ended up into the front seat of the vehicle.
Do we have enough lines? Can we get a warm blanket, please?
This is a lot more than a normal night, and here comes another one.
We just received another rescue. We have seven patients in the waiting room still, and we have no free rooms right now.
Four traumas at one time is a little bit much.
People are depending on all of us. It could be your loved one or my loved one. Sometimes, unfortunately, we do have some kind of bad things come through the front door.
When you get into medicine, you have to accept the fact that people die, no matter what you do.
To think that we can just put it in a box and internalize it isn't realistic. You never get immune to it. You never get callous to it. You accept it, and sometimes it's tears, sometimes it's faith. You know, there's a lot of different entities that that come out of it.
The last one that Mercy One flew in was the 21-year-old from this accident in Decatur County.
Usually we give report to each other so that we know what happened kind of during the night, especially if something was really serious, because we still might get family trickling in, people looking for that person. Mm-hmm. I have the phone, pager.
Hope you guys have a good day.
Thanks.
It's been steady all night.
We need to stock like crazy to get our rooms back and going after their busy night last night.
Like these were all empty. This was empty, and these bins were empty.
Mercy ER, this is Sherry. Nurses are caring people, no matter what profession they're doing, whether they're doing research, they're instructors. I just happen to be one that has a lucky, fun job of working in the ER. Emergency room, this is Sherry.